Is there something that you've always wanted to do? You planned for it, you prepped for it, you anticipated it, and as it got continued to get closer and closer to you doing whatever the thing that you were going to do, something got in the way, something changed, something happened that the thing that you wanted to do didn't happen. Happens to all of us, does it not? Things change, things happen, things go wrong. We adapt, we adopt, and we move forward. At least theoretically, that's how it works. Well, if you remember yesterday, we were talking about Paul, yes and no, and especially in relationship to his wanting to visit the Corinthian church, to go back and visit. Well, things are about to change. And we're going to find out what those things are and what the issues were and what Paul decided to do and adopt and adapt and move forward. We're going to learn all that in today's episode of The Word. Stick right with us. We'll be right back.
Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path.
Things didn't happen rightly. Things started to go wrong. Things started to change in a change pattern that we did not anticipate. So, we do something different now, right? Isn't that kind of what we always have done in life? Absolutely. And, well, that's kind of what's going on here with St. Paul, with the Corinthians. So we're going to pick it up at 2 Corinthians chapter 1. We're going to start at chapter 1, verse 23. We will move into chapter 2, verse number 4. Chapter 2, verse 4. We're going to get there. So kind of set the stage before we actually get into the text. Paul, if you recall yesterday, we were talking about the yes and the no, and how Paul did not want to be appearing as schwaffling whether I'm going to yes or whether I'm going to no. You know, in God's promises, they're always yes. So that was the teaching lesson for yesterday. But now it's more in lines of now, but now I'm going to address what I'm going to do with you. And not in the context of a parent saying, well, what am I going to do with you? No, not that way. What am I going to do with you? How am I going to work with you? What's the methodology that I'm going to work with you? That's what Paul's addressing here today. So we'll let you get your Bible set up, get ready to go moving forward, and we'll get to the text. What we're going to get into now is the reason why Paul ultimately decided, no, I'm not coming. And let's get going right here in chapter 1 of 2 Corinthians, verse 23. We're going to go to chapter 2, verse 4. But I call God to witness against me. It was to spare you that I refrained from coming again to Corinth. Not that we lord it over your faith, but we work with you for your joy, for you stand firm in your faith. For I made up my mind not to make another painful visit to you. For if I cause you pain, who is there to make me glad but the one whom I have pained? As I wrote, and I wrote as I did, so that when I came, I might not suffer pain from those who should have made me rejoice. For I felt sure of all of you that my joy would be the joy of you all. For I wrote to you out of much affliction and anguish of heart with many tears, not to cause you pain, but to let you know the abundant love that I have for you. He goes on a little further. We'll save that one for tomorrow. But here is an interesting point of view. So Paul is saying he's finally come to the conclusion that I'm not going to come visit because I don't want you to be in any more pain, hurt, sorrow, grief. I want to bring you joy because I want you to bring me joy. It's a reciprocal. It's relational. It's a relationship. It's not just somebody saying, look, this is what you must do und you will like it. Mm-mm. It's not that at all. It's a connectivity. It's a, like I said, relationship. It's a bond that Paul has with the church and that the church has with Paul. It's not just one-way relationship. It's a two-way relationship. And isn't that the way we want to have a relationship with God? Because that's what God wants with us. He wants this two-way relationship. He wants us to hear, listen, follow. He also teaches us, shares with us, shows us, motivates us, moves us to greater joy of life, as well as, now that brings him joy. And he passes that joy back to us. And it's just a continual cycle, a motion, if you will, a motion of life, a motion of relationship. And that's what Paul's kind of getting at here. I want this motion of relationship. I don't want us to be stuck in a, well, this is what Paul said, therefore we have to do it this way kind of thing. If you remember the previous letter, there was a lot of that. There was a lot of gospel in there too. We don't want to ever negate that. Yes, Paul did have some challenges with the Corinthian church and the behaviors that they were setting. But at the same time, Paul was also sharing the grace and the mercy of God, the compassion to bring the joy to them, the joy that they were finding out more fully that they have with God through Paul, and vice versa, and that Paul has through the church. It's a mutual connectivity relationship. That's what it is. So Paul is saying, I don't want to create any more angst. I don't want to create any more anxiety. So that's why I refrained from coming again to Corinth. He didn't want to be seen as someone bringing the hammer down. And that's all that Paul did, was bring the hammer down. At least that would have been a perception. No, Paul did not just bring the hammer down. Paul brought the hammer and the grace that comes, the hammer and the healing. Let's kind of use that phrase. I like that. The hammer and the healing. So he says, that's why I'm refrained. Not that we lord it over your faith, but we work with you. There's the key word right there. We work with you. And for your joy, for you stand firm in your faith. So there's the layers of encouragement right there. There's the layers of grace right there to stand firm in your faith. I made up in my mind not to make another painful visit to you. Obviously, Paul had heard that the letter had caused a little bit of consternation, which on one side of the coin, they needed. They needed the hammer blow. They also needed the grace blow. They needed the healing blow. For if I cause you pain, who is there to make me glad but the one whom I have pained? Let's say it in another way. Let's say I share with somebody that they are sinning. Now, that's never an easy conversation, especially from a pastoral point of view, and even more so from a congregant or from a believer's point of view. And it doesn't matter what the sin is. That's not the issue here. What is at issue is the grief that we both feel because sometimes we got to bring the hammer down. And it's not fun. No, you've been the recipient of the hammer. Maybe you've been the one bringing the hammer blow. It's never easy. And no matter what you try to say, that is going to bring healing and health and gospel to the scenario. There's always that level of angst and pain and sorrow. What Paul is saying here is, I don't want to come back and bring that pain to you again the minute I show up. All you think about is how you hit us over the head with a hammer, not how you helped us grow and develop as people of God in Christ Jesus, which ultimately that's what Paul did. But the point is, he's going to show up and people are going to go, ugh, what are you going to do? Hit me with another hammer again? He doesn't want to do that, and he doesn't want to do that to them, and he doesn't want to do that to himself. And when so he says, as I wrote, as I did, so that when I came, I might not suffer pain from those who should have been made me rejoice. For I felt sure of all of you that my joy would be the joy of you all. So he's saying, I wrote the gospel to you, but I'm wondering if the law is going to be stuck in your mind and you're not centering on the gospel. I want to make sure you're centering on the gospel. On both, actually. Technically, on both. For I wrote you out of much affliction and anguish of heart and with many tears. Nobody wants to tell somebody they're doing something wrong. Nobody wants to say anything to anybody. So what do? We come up with, oh, you're so great, you're so wonderful, and we gloss over the issues. That's not what Paul wants to do. But that's sometimes how we interpret it, because we don't want to bring anybody some angst saying, look, you didn't do well. Nobody wants to hear that. But that doesn't mean we don't share it. Yes, it may make the one who brings the bad news to feel bad and to experience some anguish in him or herself. But for the growth of the person, we must share both the sadness and the joy. We must share both the law and the gospel. We can't grow if we don't do both. We can't grow as saying, look, this is the way, you shouldn't have done it. We know this, you know this, I know this, and you know what? God knows it too. God knows it so much that he sent Jesus to die for you, to forgive you of all of your sins. So now, as one who's been forgiven by the grace of God through Jesus Christ, let's change the issue. Let's move forward. Let's embrace the grace. Let's embrace the love. Let's embrace the gospel. Yes, I had to bring you some agony for a little while, but I'm hoping that the grace of God will oversee and overshadow that agony. It's how we deal with relationships with people all the time, or at least that's the way God has laid out that we deal with relationships all the time. Yes, we must point out that things are going wrong. You need to, there needs to be repentance. There needs to be contrition. There needs to be confession so that you can receive the gospel more fully and to receive the fact that Jesus died to forgive you of everything. See where I'm getting at? You got to have both sides. It's not just a one-sided, oh, everything's all good, or everything's all bad. Both of those single-sided proclamations don't do anybody any good. But if you are clear and accurate and concise and honest with people, you will bring people the grace and the mercy of God more fully, and it will blossom into a grace and wonderful thing. So he says, for I wrote to you out of much affliction and anguish of heart and with many tears, because he didn't want to say it, but he had to. Not to cause you pain, but to let you know the abundant love that I have for you. The abundant agape, self-sacrificing love. I will do anything for you, Paul is saying. And that includes bringing a little bit of a hammer down. But I will also bring the grace and the mercy and the healing of God in Christ Jesus. That's how much I love you. To show and to share with you how much God loves you. You see the distinction? I love you so much. Yeah, I got to point out the problems here. But I love you enough that I can always give you the solution to the problem. And that is Jesus Christ. And that's what we want to bring to you every day. Every day that we do these devotions, every day that we do our worship, every day that we study together, we bring the solution of God into people's lives. We dialogue them, we discuss them, we community them. We connect with one another, and that's what we do. We'd love to have you a part of it as well. So, if you liked what you saw, give us a thumbs up. Like what you heard, great. If you have any comments, any questions, either from yourself or maybe a study group that you're working with, make a comment down below. Let me know, because we can engage in a dialogue. Different form, but it's still a dialogue nonetheless. And don't forget to check out some of our other videos and other live streaming and stuff like that. So I appreciate you guys being with me this morning. We'll talk again tomorrow. You guys have a great day. Bye-bye.